if it's used excessively, and if it's used in manners that you know, are harmful to others, it can be, because you know, social media can allow people to make comments that can remain as anonymous as they want to remain. And so it can be very damaging to other people if falsehoods are made regarding another individual. There's also some concern, of course, is that does it have an effect on our young people's ability to socialize, you know, in regular settings. So, but at the same time, social media has some great advantages. So it's like most anything, I think, is that properly used, it has great benefits. But even good things, if used improperly, can be very detrimental to our people.
Archbishop?
You know, it's kind of hard to pick out anything. I mean, something like this, I very much enjoy. I enjoy having the opportunity to speak to our young people, to hear from our young people, to see what thoughts are on your mind, what you're concerned about. So this is something that is very important to me. I enjoy getting out into the parishes. It'd probably be easier to ask what is the least enjoyable aspects about being the Archbishop. And there's an awful lot of office work involved with being the Archbishop. But it has to be done. And you know, I'm ordained, this year I'll be ordained 40 years to the priesthood. And of my 40 years of priesthood, I've been in administration for 37. So I'm kind of used to administration, but that doesn't mean, and I do all right with administration, but the best part is being out with people, talking to the people, teaching, listening. Those are the things that I enjoy.
Well, that is a highly debated question, of course, but, you know, first of all, as far as opening the priesthood to more broadly, I think it's important to keep in mind that the Catholic Church is not the only religious institution that is experiencing fewer people going into an ordained ministry. Many Protestant denominations are having the very same challenge, is that fewer individuals are going into the seminary and to take up pastorates of one form or another. So opening it to a larger spectrum of people isn't necessarily the answer. Now, as far as ordination of married men to the priesthood, could that change one day? Yes, it could. If that's because that's simply a disciplinary norm of the church. There's nothing theological against the ordination of married men. Ordination of women, that question was studied by Pope John Paul II, and at the conclusion of his study, he just said it is not within the authority of the church to change that particular practice. So I want to say a little bit of something about combining parishes, you know, consolidating, bringing parishes into regions. That is something that is necessary now because we do have fewer priests. But we have turned that around. When I arrived in the Archdiocese of Cincinnati 5 years ago, I think we had 27 men studying for the priesthood. This year we have 46. Next year it's looking like we will have probably around 55. So the trend is turning around. That doesn't necessarily mean that when these regions are formed, that when the number of priests becomes sufficient again, that we'll begin to break up the regions. I don't think we can do that. What we will do is we'll assign more than one priest to a region, and so that a greater number of priests to serve the people in that region. Regions aren't entirely a negative thing either. Because, especially if a region brings together a number of smaller parishes, that enables a small parish on its own doesn't necessarily have the resources to take up all the ministries that are expected of a parish today. However, if you bring several smaller parishes together in the region, then they may indeed have the resources that are necessary. And so the regionalization, yes, the fewer number of priests is one of the elements that is bringing this about. But it's also just looking at what these smaller parishes are able, can they offer all the ministries that are expected of parishes today? And many of the smaller parishes can't. And bringing them together as a region, I think we have a better, to take this opportunity to thank all of the schools, all the students that participated in this teleconference. I do enjoy it every year. I enjoy hearing from our young people because you have such great potential. And I want you to understand that I recognize the many gifts that you have to offer to the church, not only in our schools, but also in our parishes. As I go around the archdiocese, I am I'm encouraged and I'm energized by seeing what the commitment of our young people to make a difference in the world, a difference that is based upon the teachings of Jesus Christ, which we learn in our schools. So thank you very much. It's been a privilege for me to spend this time with you. So let us pray. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Heavenly Father, each day we celebrate the many gifts that you bring into our lives. And this week in particular, we thank and celebrate the gift of our Catholic schools. We ask that you continue to bless them, that they may reach out to generations of our young people for years to come, so that they may explore God's will in their life, and thereby experience the peace, the joy, the fullness of life that Christ promises. We also pray that you bless all of our school staff, administrators, teachers, for the generous way in which they give their talents for the benefit of our young people. And we thank you also for the young people themselves, that they are a true blessing to the church. And we ask that you watch over them and guide them, so that they may understand your love in their life and come to experience your love for them. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. In the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you.